Good morning and a warm welcome to the 22nd meeting of the Social Justice and Social Security Committee. We have apologies from Katie Clark. Our first item of business for today is a decision to take agenda item 5 in private. Are we all agreed? Thank you. Our next item is an evidence session on the Housing Scotland Bill at stage 1. Today we are going to hear from Paul McLennan, Minister for Housing. I also welcome his officials from the Scottish Government, Catriona McKean, Deputy Director of Better Homes, Laura McMahon, Solicitor, Legal Directorate, and Matt Howarth, Policy Officer, Homelessness Prevention Team, Scottish Government. So thank you very much for joining us today. And Minister, I believe you would like to make a short opening statement.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning. Thank you for the further opportunity to provide assurance on the Housing Scotland Bill. I understand you've agreed with the Local Government Housing and Planning Committee that you provide your Stage 1 report to them shortly, and I'm grateful for your time today. In my evidence to the committee on the 27th of June, I highlighted key measures at Parts 5 of the Bill on homeless prevention duties, which are also an essential part of addressing the housing emergency. This is both because preventing homelessness and supporting tenancies to be sustained leads to less pressure on housing supply. I also emphasised engagement with delivery partners we continue to undertake to ensure that positive and sustained change is delivered. The legislation as introduced builds on the strong housing rights that already exist for people who are homeless in Scotland by bringing a renewed focus on prevention. These preventative measures have been shaped by significant stakeholder engagement since 2020, including recommendations of the Prevention Review Group, a public consultation, and direct engagement with key organisations by both officials and ministers. The introduction of the bill, however, was never intended to signal the end of that journey. I and my officials continue to work collaboratively with the stakeholders as we develop our approach to delivering these duties in order that we can harness the opportunity to prevent and end homelessness and to make a significant contribution to eradicating child poverty. As I set out in my recent letter to you, the focus is now on plans for effective implementation of the new duties and driving forward cultural change towards shared public responsibility and earlier intervention. We hope Parliament will support this approach. Since we were last together, we have engaged with delivery partners on how the Act, Ask and Act proposals in the bill could function in practice, the social landlords on domestic abuse measures, and this has made clear how much positive practice already exists to build on, and that successful prevention is not always about doing more, but by doing things differently. Getting early intervention right will avoid someone having to retell a story multiple times to service providers. It will mean people get help faster, and it will make more effective use of public resources, which of course is a vital investment. In this way, our shared public responsibility in early intervention has the potential to also deliver financial savings. Critically, it also benefits our future health, equality and prosperity. As the new duties aim to strengthen consistency and transparency around prevention activity across Scotland through legislative change and ensuring it happens at an earlier stage, whilst maintaining person-centred, flexible approaches by addressing the needs of individuals and families. Clear messages are emerging from our recent engagement about our ambitious provisions, rebalancing the whole systems approach holistically around about homelessness prevention. I am keen to the next stage of engagement as a particular focus on how to foster partnerships and cooperation between relevant bodies as outlined in the bill in order to move on the strong rights that already exist in Scotland and move us closer towards a prevention aim. Going forward, we will continue to work collaboratively with stakeholders to deliver strong guidance, tailored to different settings and building on existing good practice, clear expectations and a joint case for the benefits of cultural change to support prevention, the resourcing, which I am clear is necessary to make the duties a success, and appropriate timescales for implementation. As part of this next phase, I will be hosting an online event in October to bring together a wide range of stakeholders, including relevant bodies and local authorities. The aim of that event is to identify how we can support the cooperation required to implement each of the homeless prevention duties and provisions in the bill. The committee, of course, are welcome to attend this event to hear the thoughts of stakeholders firsthand. In conclusion, overall, our homelessness prevention duties will help to avoid the trauma and disruption to their lives which homelessness can cause, and is critical to our vision to end homelessness in the longer term. I and my officials look forward to answering any questions members may have on the parts of the bill today. Thanks, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much, Minister, and thank you for extending that invite to the committee in terms of the event in October. I'd be keen to find out the details of that, if your officials could make the clerks aware of the dates and whatnot, and we'll make the committee members aware of that as well. So thank you for that. So we're now going to move on to questions, and I'm going to invite Jeremy Balfour in first. Thank you.
Good morning, Minister, and thank you and your team for coming. I've just got a few questions which come out of your statement. The first is in regard to ask and act duties. Crisis in their submission to the committee said what we want to see in the bill is a much deeper articulation of what is meant by the duty to act. And as I've spoken to a few stakeholders, I think there is a lack of clarity as to what it means. So I wonder if I can give an example, if you can tell me what it would mean in practice. So I'm a nurse at A&E at the Royal. On a Thursday night, somebody comes into the Royal and is obviously not got any housing. What duty to act does that nurse doctor have? And how do they do their duties in practice if this was to become law?
Yeah, I think there's a number of things, and I think first of all, excuse me, there's actually in the legislation itself, it does actually set out what the ask and what the act actually means in terms of act, and obviously is working exactly, you know, where they are just now. But one of the key things I think for, and we had a chat obviously with the NHS, and one of the things that was raised was words examples like that, for example. Now, one of the key things we have to do with the NHS was talking about training and guidance, and I think that's incredibly important in terms of what that kind of looks like. So there is that training and guidance which we will continue to work with the NHS and in different bodies within the NHS in terms of what that kind of looks like. So that is an ongoing process. I think one of the key things when we spoke to stakeholders, when we spoke to those who have been involved in that, was that particular point was around about the training and guidance. So we'll continue to work with the NHS. When we had that meeting, we talked around about the discussions with the NHS and how that looks and how we build upon that. And ACT obviously is working with the key partners. So I mentioned about the holistic approach as well. So there's obviously making sure there's a process in place to what that actually looks like. Because if somebody does come in and have that situation, how do they actually act on that? They're asking the proper questions if there is a risk of homelessness, but what is the act that they need to do beyond that? So it is the training and guidance, which I think is incredibly important on that point.
I don't know if I can please, Mr. You can only train someone if you know what you're training them in. And what are you training the nurse, the doctor to? You know, it's all right saying we're going to have training,
yep,
but what are you? What practically would you be expecting of a nurse, doctor in a busy A&E to do for someone who is homeless on a Thursday night?
I think, first of all, well, that's building on already what we have, because the NHS obviously operate with the local council on the moment at that particular time. And I've seen cases with that when we visited the Simon community, for example, in terms of how they deal and how they're passed on the cases. So that already exists at the moment. So it's already building on something that's there. It's not a case of it doesn't exist at the moment. So it's building on what's already there. So what the key thing then is trying to find out if there is somebody that comes in, what is a particular example of trying to identify what the homelessness, I'm not saying opportunity, that homelessness case kind of comes up and how they identify that. They're in this and making sure there's a procedure in place to deal with that. So it's building on what we already have in terms of that. Now, when we had the meeting last week with NHS, this is exactly what they talked about, isn't it? Talking about the guidance and training on that particular point. So these are the procedures that we're trying to build on in terms of that. And again, that already exists. So it's building on that. You know, this isn't coming from a process straight from the, you know, this already happens. You know, so we're not starting this at where we are just now. These procedures already exist. It's trying to build on these procedures, and that's a key thing. Now, this is feedback we've obviously had from people who have lived experience of this. So it's making sure if there's a nurse or whoever there is aware of the prevention duties. By that I mean, you know, are they identifying that it's a person at risk of homelessness that particular night, and who do they need to speak to in terms of that, and they're acting on that. It's not just a case of then passing it on to the local authority. But I don't know if Katrina wants to add anything on that particular point.
Yeah, I think what I would add is that the engagement we've had over the summer has helped us to start these conversations with health workers in that health context, and that's something we're looking to build on as we develop our guidance. The precise protocols that would be followed in these different situations, that's something we're keen to get into the detail of next. In some cases, as the Minister says, that's about building on the practice that is already there. In other cases, we know there will be new connections that need to be built. There will be new protocols that would need to be followed. We know that one of the key things is making sure that people are aware of the sorts of advice, advocacy, support that we can look to people in these different relevant bodies to connect people at risk into and make sure that that support is being connected up. It's also going to be about what do they do within their existing role. How does that start to play through in the way that they might provide care, for example, through a trauma-informed response? And again, that's not something that's new to the NHS, it's something that exists already. Our hope is that in this legal framework being provided, it creates that context in which these things become clearer, more formalised, planned in advance, and that it's really something that's done in cooperation and collaboration. So the approach we've got is in looking to put a lot of this into regulation so that we can be having these conversations and really building from the ground up in terms of what's going to work in different contexts. And the engagement that we've had, particularly since the bill's introduction, has really helped us start to draw out what that looks like in an A&E context. You need a very clear step-by-step approach. In a, for example, a more community care setting in health, that's going to be more fluid, more flexible. So those are the things that we're looking to get deeper into over the course of the autumn, and certainly we'll be looking to work with Crisis as we do that as well.
Before you go any further, I believe Kevin would like to come in with a supplementary.
Thank you very much, Convener. And you know, I'm glad to hear of the engagement, but I'm one of these folks who doesn't like to see the reinventing of the wheel. And I think in terms of ensuring that the secondary legislation, the guidance is right, we need to look at best practice. And the government previously ran a pilot scheme at Queen Margaret Hospital in Fife, along with Fife Council and third sector partners, which applied trauma-informed practice and was extremely successful in housing folk. It changed dramatically the way that health service staff, doctors and nurses worked with people. Now, there were protocols in place for that. Have we looked at those protocols that worked there? And are we going to apply those in terms of the secondary legislation and the guidance, or are we ignoring those?
Kevin, I'll bring in Katrina a wee second on that particular point. But I think you're right in terms of the best practice. For example, one of the people we've been speaking to and who do very well in this area is the Cyrenians, talking about hospital and reach. So that's building on good practice and the work that they've done. So we've met with Cyrenians in terms of that, the work that they actually carry out and the work that they do. So I think that's building on what's already there, and I think that's really important. Obviously, we've been speaking to the change teams as well, who obviously have experience in the healthcare sector as well. So yeah, it's building on what they're doing as well. So, and you're right, it's not about reinventing the wheel. And one of the key things for me, and you'll know, obviously being a councillor previously as well, and people arrive in homelessness in different situations. And they'll come in with different experiences. Sometimes they're really good experiences, sometimes they're not as good as what they should be. And in terms of the prevention duties, this is obviously trying to make sure that we're building on what's already there. And I think that's important. Learning from Cyrenians, learning from the change teams, and building on that. And when we spoke to the NHS teams, this is one of the key things that they were saying. It's building on that, on actual protocols. I'll bring Katrina in terms of that. But you're right, it's not just around about, you know, it's not starting anew. This is building on good practice that's there, building on the protocols that are there. And the particular case that you mentioned, I'll ask Katrina on that one. If not, I can come back to that point. But you're right, Kevin, it's building on what's already there, the good practice that's already there, to make sure that we're not, that the experience that people have is much more uniform and much better than it has been previously.
Yeah, and on the shelter project in Fife, absolutely, that's such a good example of where things work well, and the leadership of the local authority in bringing that together and supporting it to really have the impact that it did. So yeah, I'm very much looking to draw in all of these examples in our work with a range of local authorities as we try to develop these approaches. Will be really, really critical in looking at what's worked well. Not assuming that that will work well in every hospital context, in every local authority context, but taking what works well and adapting it, sharing it, building on it for other settings. Matt, I don't know if you want to say more about this area.
Yes, thanks. Actually, the project run by Cyrenians, which is an in-reach hospital project, was actually one of the events we had, one of the health event that we had. And what we tried to do at those events was, going back to the first question that was asked by the committee, was to work through explaining the legislation precisely what is meant by ASK and ACT, in the sense that ASK is very much working within your own functions. So it's not working with a new audience, it's working with the people that you are already coming into contact with now. But asking that question about housing and housing being part of your assessment of that person's needs. And then in terms of the acting, it's very much about acting within your own powers. So in the example that was given, that the action that may be taken there, if the person was actually homeless and hadn't been in contact with local authority, we would expect that to be a referral to local authority because they are homeless. This is about people who are threatened with homelessness, who housing situation or housing instability is identified. And that action may be working with other partners other than housing. It's an expectation of that the relevant bodies will ask, what can I do in my role for this person? And actually at the health event, we had people in different roles, and one of the very interesting contributions was from NHS 24 and the ambulance service, who both turned up, who said they could see the logic of doing this and how they would do it, but they would obviously need to do it in a different way to other parts of health, and they would need to possibly use a triage process in order to do the acting. So we are building on the existing examples that are already there, and I think the clear message is that a lot of this approach is already being taken across the country, but it is patchy, it's inconsistent, and the legislation potentially gives us the chance to bring some consistency across the country.
Very briefly, convener, I've given that very good example, which was highly rated by service users themselves. Can I ask around about the voices of lived experience and what works for them? Are we taking cognizance of what the voices of lived experience have to say? Because it may well be that the NHS and the third sector think that something's quite good, but in reality, those folks that are in need of those services don't necessarily share those views.
Yeah. Before you come in, sorry, Minister, I'm conscious of time here. If we could be as concise as possible with our questions and answers, thank you.
Okay, I mentioned the change team, for example, that are there who are direct experience, who have the direct experience of that. I think in looking at the start of the process, and we had that task and finish groups on as well, which included people with lived experience. So it's very much taking people with lived experience, and I think that's the most important part. Yes, we're asking for the legal duties on likes NHS and Scottish Prison Service and others, but this is around about, are we providing a service that needs to be there for the people who are at risk of homelessness? And I think it comes back to the point before, where we were previously was mixed. If you had somebody who had the necessary training or necessary guidance, then you would have the procedure coming through and people would be dealt with at an early stage. If you didn't, then obviously dependent on that. What we're trying to do is give that legal certainty, first of all, to likes the NHS and Scottish Prison Service, but also look at the training and guidance and working in partnership with these organisations to make sure that we're reaching across as far as we possibly can to give that people being identified at an early stage, asking and acting within their own duties, then passing on or through referrals or whatever. But it's very much been through the change team, working with likes of Cyrenians who deal with that as well. So very much it's a lived experience, which I think is incredibly important.
Okay. I'll bring Jeremy back in. Thanks.
Thank you, Convener. If we can move on, the Finance Committee looked at the financial memorandum.
Yes.
And you seem to have been quite critical of it. Edinburgh Council state that if we were to implement this bill as it was, it would cost around £1.9 million a year for internal staffing. The financial memorandum has a £1.6 million for all local 30 two authorities. Before stage one, are you intending to revise the financial memorandum to give actually realistic costs?
I think there's a number of reasons. I think there's, first of all, I think there's the, coming back to the, how the financial memorandum is actually set up, and one of the key things obviously is it's the best estimate, the guidelines, it's the best estimate of cost in savings. Now, we worked with COSLA in 2023 and had a joint consultation with COSLA as well in April 2022. Now, we went out to each local authority and asked for their estimates at that particular time, and obviously that helped us put that together. I think one of the key things is keeping considerations relating to is a live consideration, so it's one of the key things we're continuing to work with local authorities on. So we will be looking at that in terms of that. So there's no budget being set for this as such. But we followed, obviously, you know, the guidelines within a financial memorandum. We engaged with COSLA, we engaged with the local authorities. So the best estimate was on consulting and working with local authorities in that particular point. Yes, we'll continue to...
But in the light of information, Minister, that has now been put forward by Edinburgh Council and by other local authorities, yes. Are you going to revise it, yes or no?
And we will if we need to revise it, we will obviously revise it. And I think that's one of the key things. We will continue to engage with local authorities. When I'm meeting with local authorities, including Edinburgh, we have that level of discussion. So we'll continue to engage with them. If Edinburgh are saying that and other local authorities are doing that, of course we will look to revise it if that's necessary at that particular point. It's an ongoing exercise. But one key thing to stress is we engaged with them quite consistently prior to the financial memorandum going. But if that's something we need to look at, of course we will look at that and consider bringing that forward. I'm happy to discuss that offline with you, but I discuss this with local authorities all the time, but happy to consider that if that's information coming through.
Okay, thank
you very much. I'll come back later.
I'm conscious of time, so I'm going to invite Bob Doris now. Thank you.
Thanks, Claire. I think it was good to see the engagement over the summer period, Minister. I had raised in questions other groups that we couldn't necessarily place a statutory duty on, who would be key partners with asking that duty, in particular DWP and Home Office. I also mentioned GPs, where there may be challenges for different reasons, but there were three key organisations. Can I ask you, Minister, whether you met with any of those three bodies during the summer, and if not, would it be your intention to do so? And maybe a second follow-up question to that. We might not be able to compel and asking Act Duty on DWP, for example, but you can see clearly why, given their role within the benefits, that they might be a real central organisation. Could we still write them into legislation, placing a requirement on the Scottish Government, for example, to reach out to them to have a formal concordat or protocol, or ask them to volunteer to be part of this Ask and Act duty, because I think that would be a really powerful thing to do. So I would quite like to see them on the face of the bill or on secondary legislation, because just because we can't compel them doesn't mean we should not acknowledge in legislation the key role they have, Minister.
First of all, we'd plan to engage, yes I would, and I think that's incredibly important, and we know we have the event, I said, in October. I would plan to try and meet with them before that or just slightly after that period of time. I know you'd refer to this before, Mr Doris, so happy to do that. As you know, we can't compel the likes of the DWP, but obviously one of the discussions we can have is in terms of how we work more closely with them as we engage, as I said, with the NHS, as we engage with Scottish Prison Service and so on. But it is organisations that, you know, I'd be happy and we'll be meeting to discuss that in more detail. We can't compel them, but I think what you discussed, possible a concordat might be something that we could discuss with them at that particular time. I think until we have that discussion, it's kind of hard to see where that would evolve to, but it's certainly something that we'll be looking to engage with, not just the people who are named in the legislation, but out with us that as well. And I know there's been discussions, which I'll maybe bring Katrina or Matt on, just to give in terms at an official level in terms of that. But these are organisations intend to meet. But Katrina, Matt, I don't know if there's anything to add on discussions we've had with them so far.
Yes, and I think when we talk about best practice, there are really good examples of where DWP, Job Centre Plus have really taken forward some exceptional work in local circumstances on that voluntary basis that you've described. And I think there's a really, you know, there's a good working relationship with DWP colleagues across Scotland, and certainly something we'd be keen to unpack and look at what can be done in that regard. Similarly with the other bodies that you've mentioned there, and I think we can provide some further
I think that's helpful,
that.
Ms McKean. I'm sorry for cutting across you. I'm just conscious of time. We want to kind of keep questions moving. So would you be minded, Minister, of putting something on the face of the bill that mentions a duty in government to continue to build these relationships, because we can't put a duty on DWP, and I'm good, it's glad that there's good working practice, but we could put a duty on our own government to continue to reach out in such a way.
I'll ask probably Laura on that in terms of the legislative point of view, and you know, whether that's practical or not. Okay. And I appreciate the point that you're trying to make, and it's something I would be comfortable with. Yeah. But from a legal point of view, Laura, I don't know if you want to comment on the point that Mr Doris has made.
Yeah, thanks, Minister. So in terms of binding, I suppose, Scottish ministers to continue to work with DWP, I suppose that would only work if the duty was reciprocal, which we can't really have the legal, there wouldn't be legal certainty there in order to do that. But I suppose building on the engagement point, what we can do is engage in voluntary engagement there in terms of getting them to work with us on these duties. But we wouldn't be, as a devolved nation, looking to sort of set that out in legislation.
Right, well, that's the advice you're getting at the moment, but I'm just thinking in legislation about the Scottish Government must.
Yeah.
In legislation.
I'm happy to take that point. I mean, obviously, okay. Discuss that with colleagues, because I appreciate the point that you, and I totally understand that, but happy to come back to you on that particular point. Yeah. We can write to you on that particular point.
I'm delighted there's positive relationships ongoing, so I'm not trying to fix something that maybe doesn't need fixed. I'm just trying to get assurances for longer term. Thanks.
Okay. And again, I think that comes very much down to what the local circumstances are as well, in terms of that, but happy to come back to that point that you mentioned there.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Ros McCollin. Thank you.
Yes, thank you, Convener, and good morning, Minister and
morning.
Team. Thank you very much indeed. It's no surprise that rural issues are something that I feel very strongly about. We took evidence that stated that from ALCO that solutions need to be specifically suited to rural context. Homelessness Network Scotland also stated that probably it doesn't go far enough in terms of specific geographies and circumstances in rural areas. All for Change mentioned that travel costs and public transport are an issue in rural areas, and that there's not been any consideration given how the processes could cut them off from supply networks and other works that work in their factor. Now, that's quite a lot of information. So really what I want to know, Minister, is what considerations have you taken on board from this extra information, ensuring that rural areas are actually going to have the equality service that they require in this?
Yeah, and I think that's a really important point, because I know you mentioned that previously, and one of the key things, one is obviously that the national approach in terms of what we're trying to do, but mm-hmm. you're right, one of the key things, and you know, each local authority I've tried to is asking around about what's the circumstances in their own area, because you're right, in a rural setting it can be very different. We met just last week with 140 people who are involved in the sector from social housing kind of area to kind of talked about that. That point was kind of picked up. For me, it comes very much down to the actual local engagement and how we build it up, because having to deal with issues in rural communities as against urban Glasgow or Edinburgh is a different setting altogether. So that one of the key things in building the legislation, because it's not from a standing start. So these, mm-hmm. you know, there's already prevention duties being undertaken. It's how do we build on that? It's trying to identify the gaps that are there. We've got the event that's coming up in October, which we'll again be looking to build more on. You know, what's a holistic approach we need to build? And I think that's one of the key things, because, and again, it comes back, as you know, there are different circumstances in different areas with different people who are at different levels of understanding what their duties should be at the moment. So it's trying to identify the gaps, the more holistic approach. So the more work we've taken out, for example, in the online event in October, I think gives us the opportunity to start talking about what do we need to do and join these together. And one of the key things, I think, for me, there's also a role around local authorities to talk about the community planning kind of approach. It's not part of the bill as such, but I think the community planning element is a really important part and about how local authorities look at that as well. So, you know, that's a much more holistic approach, and having chaired the community planning team before, you know, I think that's really important about how we make sure that the services in different areas are linked up. So I think that's important. It will be an ongoing process as well. These are about trying to identify the gaps, making sure that each local authority is dealing with that in as holistic approach as we possibly can. So it's building on that. But the discussions we had, for example, with 140 practitioners, if you like, had mentioned that as well. So again, it's trying to build on these close relationships. I think having that legal duty to do so will bring them closer together, but we need to build on that. The legislation will come in. That's not the end of the process. Obviously, it's continued to build on that. And one of the key things I think we talked about was evaluation and monitoring. So we'll be speaking to the regulator around about that as well and how we build on that. So it's an ongoing process. The key part of this is trying to identify where the gaps are and trying to close these and make it as holistic as possible.
And I appreciate that, Minister. And of course, that then brings us back to what training and resources that they're going to be provided, which I do understand. And again, the point has been well made earlier on that we use best practice, but equally, we're looking at for people to ask and act, and the act follows back down to maybe two or three very specific key bottleneck points, because it's always going to come back to there for them to do the actual work to make sure that we reduce homelessness. So we're always going to have that bottleneck. How are we going to stop that bottleneck?
I think one of the key things, and it comes back, I think, to the point that Mr. Balfour made, one is the proper resourcing. Because we can have the legislation in place, we need to properly resource that. And I think that's the key thing. So where are some of the issues around about what the... So it's one's identifying where the bottlenecks is. And I think it's very clear in terms of that. When we asked around about the financial memorandum, this was asking local authorities to give their best estimate at the time. So the financial memorandum was based on that. As we get into further engagement, one of the key things then is identifying what's actual resources. And Mr. Balfour mentioned Edinburgh, for example. Yeah. If there's any circumstances or any local authority you think that you've identified, does that feed that into the team and we can pick that up. Okay. It's making sure it's properly resourced. Because I think one of the key things is identifying that if we can spend, you know, money spent on prevention saves us money down the line. I mean, that's been proven, it saves us money down the line. So it's one of the key things, how do we resource this properly? So it's identifying the bottlenecks. And I said, one rural area could be different from others, you know, from going from borders up to the Highlands, completely different circumstances with similar experience, but it's trying to identify that. But it needs to be properly resourced in terms of that. So, the more engagement we have with local authorities and deeper understanding of that, we need to make sure it's properly resourced, because it is, one, it prevents people going in that, and it's actually stopping people going become homeless. But two, it's actually a spend to save initiative in terms of that, rather than getting people going through the process. So the resourcing is incredibly important.
I appreciate it. And one last wee question. When it came to fuel poverty, again, that has a rural aspect to it. Scottish Land and Estates suggested speaking to rural landlords. Did you?
I engage with Scottish Land and Estates on a number of occasions. This issue has come up before. So we've discussed this problem with them on 4, 5, 6 occasions in the last year or so in terms of this. So this issue has been engaged, and SLE will back that up. I have engaged with them on that issue.
Okay, and rural landlords have had a play in that, not just land and
estates. We've had round tables, that's been discussed. So okay. Probably 2 or 3, if I remember correctly, but they've actually been direct involvement from landowners there.
That's brilliant, and that's making an active part in the fuel poverty.
Yeah,
side of the
I think it has to, because one of the key things I think for me is coming back to there are 32 local authorities, they're all different, and it's trying to get that approach right across Scotland.
Okay, thank you, Minister.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Paula Keane in. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Convener, and good morning to the Minister. I think one of the issues in the bill that this committee is interested in and concerned by is the domestic abuse provisions and ensuring that those are being engaged with. I noticed in the summer engagement, Minister, you met with SFHA and the Chartered Institute of Housing to discuss those provisions. So firstly, I wonder if you might want to give an update about those conversations, because I think in common with the theme around training and capacity and provision for social landlords to take the action they need to take, do you feel that those discussions were productive in understanding some of that?
Obviously, I meet SFHA on a regular basis on a number of issues. So one of the key things, obviously, because when you're dealing with, and I was just through, for example, through in Easter House, meeting the housing associations a couple of weeks ago. So one of the key things they were talking about was their wider role. One, of course, is development. Two, in terms of that wider involvement in the community, they kind of discussed. But they also then talked about their role in providing advice. Domestic abuse was one that was kind of picked up. So engaging with them, it was to try and maximise what was already there and how they work, for example, with Glasgow Council on that one. So that was one small example of a housing association. You've obviously got other ones, for example, like Sweetley Group, who have obviously more resource and more income in terms of that, who are actually trying to work very closely in terms of what the Act kind of comes through. SFHA is very much looking to try and get that uniform approach. So how do we make sure that the smaller housing associations have the necessary training? What some housing associations are doing and what the SFHA were talking about was obviously some of them to trying to pull some of the resources around about the domestic abuse part, because that's really important. And for a lot of housing associations, I think it's something that's relatively new, but something that very much came through SFHA was it's something that they're really keen to make sure that they're playing their part in. So, you know, I'll continue to discuss, obviously, SFHA. And as I said, it's easier for, like, the Wheatley Group, for example, who have that resource behind that, you can do that. But it's very much trying to, you know, how can we pull the teams in terms to that, to provide that. I visited Borders. RSLs, there was four of them down there, and they all work quite closely together in terms of what domestic abuse advice that they give on that. So it's very much building on that. It's a relatively, I'm not saying new, because they've been working on it, but it's something that they're all really keen to kind of focus on. So it's trying to say how to maximise the resource that they have in terms of that. So, and there are good examples, for example, the Border Housing Associations that I said, who work very closely together in making sure they're passing on information and so on around about that. CIH were again very similar in terms of discussions I've had with CIH is around about what's the training that's required within the housing sector itself, training around about domestic abuse, and looking at that as well was something that they had mentioned and discussed. And again, that's ongoing discussions around about the CIH and the whole housing kind of sector and building that up as well. So these are ongoing discussions.
Yeah. And thank you for that answer. I think similar to Mr. Stewart's comment about not reinventing the wheel, a lot of good practice already exists out there, and a lot of RSLs have good policy. I think the challenge very often is ensuring that, you know, those policies can be put into practice and the action can then follow, which everyone would want to see in these scenarios. And I know that both Scottish Women's Aid and the Scottish Women's Convention, in terms of their response to the bill, have pointed that you know, the actions that were outlined in the recommendations within the Improving Housing Outcomes report for women and children experiencing domestic abuse still have to be pushed forward and not lost in the context. Yeah. So I wonder if the Minister might say something about progress on that and engagement with that piece of work.
We are still engaging on that. I've been Katrina, and who's been involved in some of these discussions around about that. But that's something, obviously, that's within colleagues in criminal justice are kind of trying to push that on. And it is something that's very cognizant of, because I think it's important that we need to get that moving as we move forward with the bill. But I'll bring Katrina in on that particular point. I know she's been involved in the discussions directly about that as well.
Yes, and the inclusion of the requirement in the housing bill to have a domestic abuse policy for all social landlords is a really significant and enabling step. I think that will, it really is driving some of that engagement, that additional engagement, extra attention that the Minister has been describing from landlords, which has been really welcome and helps us to also draw out that good practice and start to bring that together. Absolutely agree that the totality of that work needs to be looked at and part of our implementation inform the guidance, in particular the requirement for a gendered analysis of policies, of processes, so that we're really supporting social landlords and other partners to really take that approach, so that there's an understanding of how services being delivered are as important as what the service is. So absolutely looking to take that forwards as part of that wider piece of implementation that will be following in the wake of the bill.
I think there's another thing to add. Mr. Crane, just on that as well, is obviously we're talking about social landlords. I think we've had discussions with the PRS sector as well, and as you know, they're hundreds of thousands involved in the PRS sector. So we've met with the Scottish Association of Landlords to discuss around about what their approach would be in terms of that. And they're aware in terms of what they need to look at. So there's discussions ongoing within the broader PRS sector as well, when it comes down to individual, obviously, landlord or landlord who have a small number of properties. But that's something, again, that we're focusing on and working with SAL. But they know they need to develop that, but we're discussing that with them as well.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Marie McNair, who's actually joining us online.
Good morning, Minister and officials. Really, it was kind of my questions on the back of Mr. Keane's, obviously, kind of what engagement, you know, have you had with like Scottish Women's Aid organisations? Obviously, they raised concerns about, you know, the Equally Safe framework not aligning with the bill, and also other issues, you know, about the victim's not been notified of perpetrators' release from prison, etc., and obviously they can impact that in terms of homelessness and all that. So I'd be grateful if you could maybe speak about that if possible.
Yeah, again, I've met with Scottish Women's Aid on a regular basis where this has been discussed, and I think that's incredibly important. And you gave a couple of examples there, one for about the Scottish Prison Service, and that these are obviously one of the key stakeholders, so we've discussed that with them as well, and that'll be something we'll be developing further with them in terms of that. Yeah, and again, it's trying to build on best practice. We heard a couple of examples where that, you know, where this, you know, I suppose, where more, you know, some prisons are probably further ahead than others, and one of the key things they talked around about that was consistency. So I think that's an important point. I think more broadly, in terms of how we deal with domestic abuse, I mean, in my time as a councillor, you've seen, and you'll be the same, Ms McNair, in terms of that, about how that was handled. And I think part of that is obviously making sure that, one, that we're properly resourced, and part of that is a training, because having dealt with, and I've seen this firsthand, and obviously through people with lived experience, sometimes it depends who you ended up with in the local authority. You know, if somebody had the necessary training, and they knew how to deal with it, and had that the necessary, I suppose it comes back how to deal with somebody that's in a trauma situation, and then you could get a situation where somebody hadn't been trained and it actually made the situation worse. So one of them obviously is talking about how do we make sure, for example, around about the Scottish Prison Service, that there's you know, how do we inform at local authorities, for example, and again coming back maybe through NHS or whoever, or through the Women's Aid themselves, that they're aware of that. So again, it's trying to strengthen on what already is there. But I've seen examples where it's been, you know, the council have dealt with it very well, and that helps the person in the situation quite quickly. Or if it's not dealt with, you know, you've seen the situation, you know, where it can actually place more trauma on that. So again, it's just more focused on, again, it's a more holistic approach. Why have this has happened if it's, nobody's getting the, you know, we've passed on from Scottish Prison Service or NHS or Women's Aid themselves into local authority? Because it does make the situation worse if it's not handled well. So there's discussions obviously going on with the local authorities. The discussions we had for the practitioners, I mentioned about 140 practitioners, was an issue where it was kind of raised. So again, when we have that event in October, I think that's the point, that, you know, if you can attend, is raising at that particular point. But it has been discussed within local authorities, within the Scottish Prison Service and so on, and with discussions with Women's Aid. And again, it's building on what's already there, and I think the legislation that comes in gives that legal duty to make sure that we're picking up on that. But yeah, we can't have that inconsistency and that we've got at the moment.
As you say, there's a lot of good practice already happening in other councils, so I certainly welcome that in the further work you're doing.
Good. Thank you.
Okay, I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour to come in very quickly, and then I'll invite Kevin in. Thank you.
Thank you. Just two very quick questions, Minister, if that's okay. It's just going back to the practice of children being held in temporary accommodation. Again, crisis, and Mr. Mission said 10,000 children in Scotland. I know it's a concern for you, it's a concern for everyone in the Parliament. How does the bill change what will happen to these most vulnerable people in society?
In terms of the
legislation, how it will actually work, you know, what difference will it make to a local authority if this becomes an act in regard to dealing with those children in temporary accommodation?
I think there's a number of things. I think there's the policy that's wrapped around. I'll come into the bill in a little second. I think in terms of the legislation that's wrapped around about that, I think that's really important. The policy that's wrapped around about that's important. Now, for example, I think we just met with COSLA last week. There was acquisition funding, additional acquisition funding that was talked about that. Now, they agreed at that particular stage to try and focus on the local authorities who have more pressures at the moment than others. And now that's ability to look at acquisitions and also so voids. We also had the Housing 2040 strategy group that met a couple of weeks ago, and one of the key things that we said at the moment was, one, was trying to make more properties available in terms of that, and a real focus on how we get, you know, specifically children in temporary accommodation out of that as soon as we possibly can. So that's the actual supply side, I think, if you like, in terms of how we deal with that. I met with Glasgow last week, and we talked around about Glasgow's probably the local authority that's got the biggest issue at the moment. So how do we talk around about trying to bring more supply in terms of that? Again, voids, acquisitions, allocation policies, and so on. I think one of the key things when it comes to the legislation is that holistic approach. And again, it comes back, for example, around about being trying to get away between the 2 months and the 6 months. And you'll know, being a councillor as well, 2 months for somebody who's trying to present as potential homelessness, homeless isn't enough. You know, we need that. And I think that part of the legislation on its own, just trying to identify what that risk could be, I think is a really important part. Now, some of that, and as we know, the crisis themselves, the Homeless Monitor talked around about the two biggest drivers for homelessness and the rise in homelessness, particularly around about families with children, was about local housing allowance. Again, that's something I'll be picking up with my UK government equivalent and tried to do that previously, and the level of universal credit as well. So it's trying to deal with poverty. A lot of people are arriving in that situation in poverty. So I think in terms of trying to identify that six-monthly approach, I think is incredibly important, because if there is that necessary help that they can get financially, I think that's really important. And I think, again, if the holistic approach within local authorities, and also, you know, if it's the NHS, for example, or link workers, because one of the key things, I think, on an NHS level was the experience of link workers. And I met with link workers in Edinburgh probably 6 or 7 months ago. And one of the biggest drivers about people getting into that situation in Edinburgh was poverty. So it's trying to identify the link workers and what their role is within the broader NHS to try and pass people on, to try to get financial advice and so on as well. So that's kind of picking up in terms of the key things. So it's the 6 month, I think, is incredibly important. It's the engagement, for example, with the NHS and what their approach is in terms of trying to identify problems at an early stage. And I think that these are one of the key things. Again, you might have a situation if it's with children, but about a fifth to a quarter of women who end up in homelessness are through domestic abuse. So again, that's engaging the likes of Women's Aid, or if people are in a hospital situation in terms of that as well, it's identifying that, you know, if somebody has suffered domestic abuse, they might end up in hospital. So how do we pick on that? There's a number of occasions. The real thing is coming back to that holistic approach and dealing with it at a much earlier stage, and I think that's an incredibly important part. And again, I think it comes back to the point it was made by Ros McCall. It's trying to make sure that we're dealing with that not just in urban settings, but we're dealing with that in rural settings as well. So it's very much the early engagement and holistic approach that the bill is pushing, I think, is an incredibly important part.
Thank you. I'm now going to invite Kevin Stewart, and thank you.
Thank you, Convener. One of the things which is highlighted in some of the communication that you've sent to the committee is about a lack of consistency.
Yep.
You highlight that in terms of SURE standards.
Yep.
You have stated that there is best practice out there. And quite frankly, those of us around the table know that in some places the practice is pretty abysmal. How are you going to ensure that consistency, uniform consistency, good practice is brought forward by the use of the bill and regulation? As a final point, convener, one of the things which happened during the course of the COVID emergency was folk just getting on with it and making sure that we met people's needs. How do you make sure that ethos carries on? And what have you been doing to look at what happened during COVID to help shape this bill and the regulation to be the best that it possibly can be?
I think there's a number of things. One, as you said, is building on best practice. And you mentioned about the SURE standards, and we talked to the Scottish Prison Service around about that. And I think one of the key things is ongoing engagement with them.
So can I? You say you've talked, and you've said that you've talked to a lot of people.
Yeah.
Which is not a bad thing. Talking and listening is good. But you know, have you instructed? Have ministerial colleagues instructed the Scottish Prison Service to ensure that best practice is exported right across the Scottish prison estate?
I wouldn't say instructed, because I think one of the key things, and this is, you know, whether dealing with health and social care or the Scottish Prison Service, it's very much working with them as partners, and I think that's the important part. And one's learning from the lived experience of people who have had, you know, had to go through the Scottish Prison Service or NHS. So I think it's very much the co-design and co-production in that. And I know when, you know, in terms of the National Care Service, I think that was something you were really keen to talk about, was the co-design and co-production, which I think is, for me, the really important part. It's building that together and building on the best practice. So we'll be meeting the Scottish Prison Service again on a regular basis to do that. I think there's a challenge of within the organisation to try and work with them to try and build on the culture that's already there. And I think, you know, they're really keen to build on that. Partners are coming and speaking to us around about, not just in terms of what they do within their own service, but how can they work closely with the likes of the NHS and other parts of that. So I think it's very much the co-design and co-production in terms of what they need to do.
So I get that point of co-design, co-production, cooperation. But there comes a point where, you know, in terms of scrutiny, if a body is not carrying out what it needs to be doing, as in adhering to the SURE standards, there has to be a way of holding that body accountable. How are you holding them accountable for not reaching the standards?
I think in terms of, for example, SURE standards, there would be the prisons inspectorate who would look at things such as that on specific points around about the prisons. I think one of the key things in terms of that is obviously we're in discussions with the Scottish Housing Regulator in terms of what that kind of looks like. So, you know, in terms of kind of building on that, I think one of the key things, because you're right, I mean, there's no point in just trying to say, look, you know, we're trying to get the improvement. How do we evaluate that? How do we monitor that? And I think that's the important part in that and kind of going on. I think that's one of the key things as well. And one of the things we talked about, for example, within the prison service was on about remand prisoners. So what do they need to do in terms of when prisoners are released early? What do we do around about that? Now, again, some of that would be around about the prison inspectorate and what do they do. In terms of how we work in with the housing regulator, that's something we're in discussion with them at that particular moment. I'll maybe ask Katrina to come in and say, or Matt, is there anything else on that particular point? But we are engaging with the housing regulator to say, right, OK, how do we value that? How do we monitor that? In terms of that. And again, you know, some of the key things we'll be getting some of the figures from the housing from the local authorities themselves and engaging with them on a local basis, how important that is. But we are discussing that with the housing regulator to make sure that the standards we expect and how do we measure that and evaluate that will be part of the discussions kind of going forward. But I don't know if Katrina or Matt has anything to add on that.
Yes, and just as with Ask and Act coming in as a new duty on the relevant bodies being within their existing powers. So you ask and you act within those existing powers. We're also looking to the existing regulatory frameworks. How do we need to shift the way that those regulatory frameworks work on the existing relevant bodies to account for this new duty, the new legislation that's coming in a way that does practically respond to what we think is possible, what we think will be beneficial, and that will be the key way that we're looking to ensure that there's accountability and monitoring across the new system. In terms of the exact nature of how that comes about within the prison service, I think the SURE standards are such an important piece of work and in some cases well established, well understood, but certainly not consistent in the way that we would hope they would be. But that has to be a key starting point for those discussions in terms of the Scottish Prison Service. Matt, I don't know if you want to come in with some more detail. Or
obviously conscious of time. I've got a quick question before we conclude, Minister. So what work, if any, has been done on stigma in relation to homelessness?
In terms, within the bill itself?
Yeah.
I think there's that, you know, and you'll know, in terms of having to deal with the situation and people arriving there, nobody wants to be homeless. Nobody wants to be there. Some people arrive there very quickly for various reasons. I think one of the key things in terms of the wider discussions we've had with the likes of the Scottish Prison Service, for example, it's how we deal with prisoners who, for example, are leaving there, and the stigma. If we don't deal with it, particularly in remand prisoners, they'll end up sleeping on a friend's couch, they'll end up sleeping rough, they'll end up doing that. So one of the key things, obviously, is to try and avoid that kind of situation on its own. In terms of looking at, again, through the NHS, it's trying to engage with the NHS at that local level as well. So not so much, you know, let's discuss stigma as such, but it's in terms of, you know, how do we deal to make sure that people are, and this is, comes back to the whole crux of the matter, is how do we deal to give that people that respect that they deserve at that particular point in terms of how they're dealt with. So we can't have people just leaving prison and going to sleep on a friend's couch or sleeping off. That's okay. Why it's really important from the 2 months to the 6 months or trying to deal with remand prisoners and in a way that kind of deals with that. It's the same with domestic abuse. Because again, women suffer stigma because of domestic abuse. So if we are trying to identify potential around about how we deal with domestic abuse cases 2 months rather than the six months rather than the 2 months, I think it allows, in a way, to trying to deal with the situation on a much quicker basis and manage it as best as it possibly could be. We talked about the fund, I think we talked about the fund to leave, which was brought in, and we worked with, very closely with Women's Aid in terms of that, giving women the ability to leave with funds that were there as well. So it's trying to build on that, trying to manage the situation rather than in a position where people very quickly become homelessness, and it, you know, and it is literally a crisis situation at that particular point. So I think that whole stigma point, I think, is dealt with within the whole thing in terms of that. So, but it's trying to plan it as much as possible. Moving from the 2 months to the 6 months and the legal obligations, I think, gives us ability to do that.
Okay, thank you. I'd like to thank your Minister and obviously your officials as well for coming along today. The committee will report on the evidence we have taken on the bill to the local government housing and planning committee in the coming weeks. I now suspend this meeting to allow for the set-up of the next agenda item. Thank you. Welcome back. We're now going to hold our first evidence session as part of our annual pre-budget scrutiny. So each year the committee reviews potential considerations for the Scottish Government's budget planning, and this year our focus is on how the Scottish Government's approach to fair and efficient funding can support the ongoing effectiveness of the third sector. So over the summer we ran a call for views, and we also held workshops with third sector organisations to hear the funding difficulties within the sector. So I now welcome our first panel of witnesses. So we have Shelley Ogilvie, Public Affairs Officer for the SCVO. We've got Sarah Latto, Senior Policy Officer, Volunteer Scotland. Douglas Westwater, Chair of Social Enterprise Scotland. Tim Frew, Chief Executive, YouthLink Scotland. And Ian Bruce, Chief Executive, Third Sector Interface Network Scotland. So thank you so much for accepting our invitation, and thank you also for taking part as well in our call for views. A few points to mention about the format of the meeting before we start. We have roughly about an hour, just to make you aware of that, and if you please wait until I or the member asking the question say your name before speaking. And can I ask everyone to keep their questions and answers as concise as possible? So I'm now going to invite the members in to ask questions to yourselves. So the first person that I'm going to invite is Ros McCall. Thank you.
Thank you, Convener. And hello, everybody. Thank you very much for coming along. I'm looking at theme one, which is funding stability and longer-term funding. Now, pretty much everybody came back with underscoring the instability caused by the lack of multi-year funding. But equally, we've got a bit of a juxtaposition that Social Enterprise Scotland highlighted, that there's potential drawbacks to multi-year funding. Missing deadlines, possibility, or fair to secure funding may face longer wait times before reapplying. So that's an interesting juxtaposition. So I'm really interested in what the panel are thinking as to both those sides of it. Obviously, it really is important that we look at multi-year funding, but equally we've got that juxtaposition. So can I have your views on it? I'm just going to work my way down the line. So if we could start with Ms. Ogilvie first, please, that would be great.
Yeah, I think one of our concerns would be that multi-year funding on its own is not the answer to fair funding. It's one element of fair funding, but fair funding is a much more broad package of reform. It's not solely multi-year funding. So one of the risks would be that, yes, there is multi-year, but it's not flexible. It doesn't include any sort of uplifts and all the other elements of fair funding that are essential to make the sector more sustainable. Mm-hmm. I think as well, multi-year funding doesn't need to exclude any other type of funding. Like generally, year on year, for a lot of organisations, their funding is very similar. And for those organisations, obviously, it makes sense that that funding should be multi-year, because each year they're getting very, very similar amounts. But for sort of small amounts of project funding or areas that would benefit from more flexible types of funding, we're not saying there should only be multi-year funding. There are situations where sometimes there is reasons for shorter term funding, but the majority of funding should be multi-year.
Okay, thank you. Ms. Latto.
I think for us, we would just be really clear to say that the benefits of multi-year funding far outweigh any potential drawbacks. Obviously, coming from a volunteering perspective, we know that single-year funding is really challenging, particularly in volunteer-led organisations, but also in organisations that involve volunteers, just because of the lack of stability and the challenges with recruiting volunteers, which we know is becoming more and more of a challenge. There are potential ways that you could address the challenge that Social Enterprise have identified. So you could stagger your funding, so you could have it so that not all of your funding starts starts say 2024 and finishes 3 years later. It could be that you hold some of that funding back and then have more funding starting the next year. So it's fairly easy to do that. You could also have annual annual review periods as well to make sure that that funding is still relevant and it's still something that organisations are looking for. So I think for most organisations, multi-year funding is still the best, as Shelley said, multi-year funding is still the best approach, but there are ways around it if you just that you could bake into the design, I suppose.
Okay, thank you. Well, that says to me that there's an added benefits with it, but equally there's a possibility of increased red tape, increased processes, different ways of doing things. Is that not just going to create a really muddy pool when we're looking at funding? Sorry, I know you raised that point, sir, but I'm actually needing to speak to everybody. But so if Mr. Westwater could answer sort of along those lines, is it not just muddy the water?
I think it probably muddies the water for the funder. I think I think from our perspective, the concern was, I think 3-year funding, I think everybody will say to 3-year funding or longer term if necessary, 10-year funding. Longer funding, the better, as it creates stability and allows people to be creative and innovative and actually allows people to start to generate some of their own money and use the resources they've got to actually make that much more sustainable. So that's really important. I think the concern is about cycles of funding. So funding, right, well, we're going to have 3 years funding, but it's going to be announced this date, but now there's no more funding for another 3 years. You've then got a really lovely, amazing, innovative group appears in year one. They've got to wait 2 years. They'll probably go elsewhere or disappear. So I think you're right. I think that causes problems for the funder, for the government. That causes problems. It absolutely does. It's not neat. It's not easy to manage, but it has much greater impact out in the third sector, which, of course, has long-term savings for the government because those beneficiaries are providing health and social care and all sorts of things. So that long-term has a financial saving to government. But you're absolutely right, it will create an administrative headache, I think.
OK, thank you. Mr. Prue.
Thank you. For me, it's about whether it's how well managed the funding is, whether it's multi-year or annual funding. And we can see good practice and bad practice in both those places. So I think for me, some of the big funders like Big Lottery and Robertson Trust and others have got, you know, good success stories around longer term funding, but it doesn't mean that they don't do short term opportunities as well. From the children and young people sector, there's been a lot of uncertainty around the Children and Young People Families Fund and Adult Learning Fund. And in that fund, I think that was an example of a fund that hasn't been so well managed from the point of view that entrants over 7 years ago were looking at a 3-year fund and it's still continuing and it's just a kind of roll-on, roll-on. So one of the challenges for that is that for existing grantees, they don't get the chance to, you know, they've speculated on the basis of a budget that they've done 6 or 7 years ago. And then what's happening is they're making adjustments as they go, and that's quite challenging in terms of impact or other outcomes that they want to change. It's also a barrier for new entrants, that particular fund, so people who have actually put in for their charity are not able to kind of get into that fund. Against the wider sort of challenge of children and young people funding in particular, and trying to look at a kind of collaborative approach across, you know, with, you know, parity of esteem with local government and some other central government funding to plan ahead. I would say we do need multi-year funding to do that, to be on an even keel, but what we need to do is have it kind of well-resourced and managed so that there's not a barrier to new entrants. Other people have said staggered release of funds. I think that's an option. I don't think that all necessarily means lots of red tape. I think that's just about, you know, that being clear from the beginning what the options are. The guidance is very clear. One of the challenges we have in the third sector is that the conditions and the hoops change as we go in terms of the process. So if the process is clearly marked out, then I don't think it needs to have additional red tape. It just needs to be kind of well managed.
Okay, thank you. Mr. Bruce, obviously we've heard a lot of information and I accept that there's a lot of overlap. Would again, specific question, would actually just shifting the time frame early in the financial year make a difference, or is just it needs to be relooked from the start in effect when it comes to this multi-year process?
So I think that goes back to Shelley's point, which is that fair funding is part of a wider set of things. So decisions made earlier in the financial year is absolutely helpful, but there is a reality which is the annual funding for and particularly when you're talking about organisations that are providing services to the public, generally working with people who may be vulnerable, maybe disadvantaged. When you talk about insecure funding for third sector organisations, what you're actually talking about is insecure services for people. And that reality that funding for 1 year means an organisation is spending a significant amount of time at the start setting something up, reduced time in the middle, and then having to anticipate an exit. So absolutely, making the decision earlier in the process is helpful, but I don't think that is the same as giving organisations confidence that their project can run for an extended period of time.
Okay,
and I think just very quickly on the staggering funding, I think that is a logical solution and that fits with how most third sector organisations are funded, which is that they have multiple funders. And if you're very, very lucky, you've got a few three-year funding programmes and they're not all finishing on the same 31st of March.
That makes a lot of sense. Does anybody else want to just pop back in on any of the additional points and then I'll finish up? Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, and just on the idea that it would be more red tape, I think it's just important to highlight that the funding model at the moment is very, very inefficient. A lot of time and resources are wasted to constantly applying for funding, both by Scottish Government and by people in the third sector. So multi-year funding will be more efficient, even if there has to be scope for flexibility within that. And a lot of that is about building relationships with people in the sector and working together to find solutions if there are any hiccups.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Bob Dorris.
Thank you very much, Convener. I'm going to try and squeeze in a supplementary to Ros McCall as part of my line of questioning. I'll maybe come to Ian Bruce. Scottish Government, of course, has indicated it's sympathetic and would like to find a way forward for multi-year funding. They would also indicate, I suppose, this financial is a good example. They still don't know what their finance is going to be in this year. Yes, it's had to set a budget for this year, let alone budgets for future years. Other than getting more certainty from the UK Government, is there any other workaround you can see to that, Mr Bruce, like guaranteed funding year one, but a guaranteed floor in funding year two of 80%, going forward to year two, year three, waiting to see what the UK Government settlement looks like to Scotland? I'm not suggesting that as a specific solution. The point I'm making is I'm highlighting the challenges and other workarounds. It might well be Mr Bruce that gets to come in relation to this, because I want to go into my other line of questioning, but do you have sympathy for the situation the Scottish Government finds itself in relation to this?
Yeah, and I think that's a reflection. And we work an awful lot with local government across the network, works with local government across Scotland, and they have a similar challenge in terms of where their funding comes from. I think that would be a substantial improvement if we were to get to a point that at least organisations knew that they had a baseline, while recognising that there might be additional resource in particular years if that became available. I suppose I would reflect on it in that way, that actually you're setting a baseline and there might be more, rather than you're setting a baseline and there might be less, is probably quite critical in terms of how both parties think about that.
Okay, and I apologise for saying, if anybody else wants to respond on this incredibly briefly, because I've got another line of questioning, feel free to come in, it's up to yourself, you don't have to.
I may just make the small point that the UK Government has said that they are looking to have three-year spending reviews in future. So hopefully we are going to... I'm hopeful, and hope you all are too, that we are going to enter a situation at some point where Scottish Government have a bit more confidence on what they'll get from UK Government, and that will flow down to the sector. I mean, that would be really great if we did get to that point, and we're hopeful.
But yeah, I think that's really helpful. I think that's an acknowledgement that the lack of these three-year spending reviews is a barrier to multi-year funding settlements for the third sector. Mr Westwater, hold on to that thought. I'm going to ask my next question, and if you can squeeze a comment in during the next question, please do that. So this is not about the amount of funds that the third sector gets, or whether it's multi-year funds. Irrespective of the funds the third sector get, we're hearing that the balance between core funds, restricted funds, project-only funds and a real lack of flexibility is putting at risk the sustainability of some third sector organisations, and we need to just do better in relation to that. So any comments and reflections of what those barriers are because of the lack of flexibility and not be able to wire some money over to core funds, for example, to do something innovative perhaps? I see Mr Frew nodding his head, so maybe we start with Mr Frew.
Yeah, I suppose what I'd like to say in terms of the period during COVID in particular, there was a lot of more unrestricted funding, and some of the conditions that we had in place were removed, and that actually gave an opportunity to have more of a needs-led approach in terms of some of those outcomes. We also were an agency that provided funding via the government to critical kind of things that were happening for children and young people. I think what we, I recognise that for some funders there might maybe kind of concern about the sort of overall picture and how do they manage that. But I think when you've got intermediaries, especially in Scotland, who are often very closely connected to the sector, there's that opportunity to use them, to use their knowledge to get the money to where it needs to go, and to, especially for proportionality in terms of that funding for some small-based projects where it's actually quite low in terms of the amount of investment. If the relationships are there, then there's an opportunity to trust that that's going to be delivered. We're not talking about huge procurement contracts that are going to private business here. We're talking about third sector who are partners with, in the delivery of public services, who have a long track record and history of delivering. So I think if we can remove some of that, where you can actually reallocate funds proportionately, that makes a lot of sense.
Okay, that's it. Mr. Westwater, you can squeeze in your other reply if you wish at this point.
Yeah, I'll be really, really brief. I mean, I was really just thinking in terms of other models, is that I think there's potentially a middle ground in terms of that long-term funding. Totally understand that, I mean, lottery, obviously maybe nobody will buy lottery tickets tomorrow morning, so it's quite hard for all funders to plan. But I think if there can be something like happens in the contractual world, where you can say, right, you've won this tender, you've won that tender, it's a two-year tender, but actually there might be extensions into year three and four if things go well, that organisation go, well, okay, we know it's only guaranteed for 2 years, but we know that there's a possibility, there's a commitment in thinking, and it's a relationship then between the funder and the fundee. So something like that with potential break, commit a longer term commitment with break clauses, knowing there's external issues. So it was just a thought about who would potentially do that. In terms of the unrestricted funding and flexibility, I couldn't be more positive about that. And in our experience, both with my Communities Enterprise Chief Executive hat on and our organisation working with community groups and social enterprises right now, there's a huge crisis out there and people are closing at a rate of knots. We're seeing people really, and actually giving them project funding is actually damaging rather than positive, because it just creates another project to run. And we've talked to some funders who are really committed to giving unrestricted funding, and I said to them, but what if that organisation just puts that money in reserves? And they say, well, we trust them, we get to know them, we build a relationship. If that's what they need to feel secure and therefore be creative with their other work, then we trust them to do that. So there's a creativity and a trust and a risk around about all of that. That's different from, there's your 100,000, we need 10 people in jobs. There's a different relationship.
I think that's really helpful, Mr. Westwater. I think the music we're getting at were away day with the third sector was very much, Ms. Lattle, was, look, yes, we'd like more money, but please free us up to do better with the funds we've actually got. Is that something you recognise? Ms. Lattle.
Oh, sorry. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. I think something that came out when we were consulting with the Policy Champions Network about this is that one of the key strengths of the voluntary sector is that it can be nimble. And Tim mentioned about the fact that during COVID, voluntary sector was provided with much more unrestricted funding. And it meant that we were able to really show our strengths and respond and meet need quickly in a way that other public services maybe wouldn't be able to do. And I think just thinking about it from a volunteering perspective as well. So we know that in the past couple of years, we've relaunched the Volunteer Charter, which sets out the sort of 10 principles for sort of sustainable engagement of volunteers. And the reason that we chose to launch it at that time is because we were seeing an increase in volunteers being involved in activity that was maybe not quite, wasn't of the best standard, or they weren't getting the support that they require. And all of that infrastructure that supports sustainable volunteer involvement, and it'll tie across to other forms of activity as well, is that it's reliant on that core infrastructure, so that sort of support network, that training, all of those things that often with project funding you don't get, it isn't covered.
That's brought the agreement across the panel. Now, Mr. Bruce and Ms. Ogilvie, if there's something very specific to say that we haven't heard already, please do come in and say it briefly, but otherwise I intend leaving my line of questioning there, but I assume there's broad agreement amongst the witnesses. Mr. Bruce.
Very broad agreement. I think just specifically for me, there's two interconnected things here. One is organisations having the resources to run the central functions of their organisations, and that very much is tied into some of the language we hear from funders, including in the public sector, around reducing management costs and 10% overhead caps and these sort of things, and trying to starting to support people to recognise that that's actually the investment in the organisation. But the connected thing is the capacity of organisations to build reserves, and I think there's a really fundamental bit in there. So at the moment, local authorities are given funding and are able to use some of that funding to build reserves so that they can function. How do we shift the mentality around how we think about funding third sector so that we actually go, it's not unreasonable for you to take a small amount of this and use it to increase your reserves, because that's about how you build sustainable.
I was just noting Miss Ogilvie was nodding her head quite vociferously at that
yeah.
point.
So I agree, I think it's been covered. So. Yeah.
Okay, thank you.
Okay. Thanks very much. I'm going to invite Kevin Stewart, and then I'll bring in Marie, who's joining us remotely. Thank you.
Thank you very much, convener, and good morning to the panel. I was smiling a fair bit when Ms Ogilvie was mentioning three-year spending reviews, because UK three-year spending reviews didn't always formulate into logical budgets over those 3 years. But I want to go on the trust aspect here, because I think that's a very important one. Mr Bruce just talked about the building of reserves and how local authorities are allowed to do that. The reality is, in Scotland at this moment, some local authorities have got huge reserves that they should be spending. Others have got next to nothing at this moment. The trust element, do you think that it would be easier to garner that trust if you had multi-year funding, so that there was the ability to look to see what organisations were doing over that 3-5 whatever year period? And we'll start off with Ms Ogilvie, please.
Yeah, I think that multi-year funding will allow organisations in Scottish Government to build relationships together, and through building relationships that creates trust. As long as there's flexibility built into the funding, so that that there's shared risk between the funder and at the moment a lot of the risk is on the sector, and there's no flexibility for, like, over the last few years we've seen a lot of things come up, COVID, inflation, they've had a big impact on the sector and led to a need for more funding. So yeah, I think multi-year funding will foster trust.
Grand. Ms Lasso.
Yeah, absolutely. I think trust is pretty fundamental, and it goes back. So there was some research that was undertaken by the Scottish Government in 2023 that looked at the relationship between the third sector, the response of the third sector to the COVID-19 pandemic, and it recommended that it should be an opportunity to reset the relationship with the third sector, between the third sector and the government. But actually, it feels like we've kind of gone in the wrong direction, and that trust is really sort of starting to wane, just because we've not had that kind of multi-year funding.
Do you think that trust has waned because funding is not so readily available, and in fact, we're in a belt tightening situation with continued austerity?
Partly, but I think also it's about the transparency and the communication between the funders and the organisations that they are working with. I think another thing as well that certainly came up when we were preparing for this inquiry is the power imbalance between the government or funders and the organisations that support them. So we certainly heard from organisations that weren't keen for their name to be put to any kind of response to this inquiry, just because they were concerned about biting the hand that feeds them and not wanting to be seen to be, just in case it had an impact on their funding. So I think that there needs to be that recognition at the moment. There is a power imbalance, and it's probably more acute just now because there is so little money to go around. So absolutely, there's definitely an element of there's less money, so that does create a bit of a tension, I suppose. Sure. But I think that if we looked at the process and we looked at communication and transparency, then a lot of that trust could be built back up again.
Gentlemen, have you got anything to add to that? Mr. Westwater.
I think the trust is really interesting. That's where it fits with long-term funding and unrestricted funding, because you can't. But trust, you need to get to know somebody before you can trust them, and just getting an application and scoring it and giving people money is not based on trust, but it does take a longer term relationship. So that funding relationship between funder and fundee, and also I think it's about impact, because there's the programme for government yesterday, so there's a whole load of things around poverty and community wealth building and all sorts of things. The government needs that to happen, that's been set out, and the third sector are one of the major elements in Scotland that can make that happen. So it's about that partnership and trust and the impact that can happen. So we the third sector are delivering that, making that difference on the ground, almost making that reality on the ground happen. And I think that's where that trust can work.
Mr. Fruit?
Yeah, no, I would agree. I think there's a danger in a time of diminishing resources that we start bean counting and start to get into that focus around the very detailed outputs. But you know, it's quite clear from understanding that we're actually talking about national performance framework and bigger outcomes, that if you start to overprescribe outputs, and you're doing that at a top level rather than listening to the needs of those who are actually delivering the activity, you can get unintended consequences, and some of the targets that you say are actually unhelpful. What I've perceived is that over time, over the last, you know, post-COVID, is that there's more stepping in. So we have, you know, if we've got intermediaries or other funding groups, they're not being trusted as much as they were, and there's more prescription coming in. So one of the challenges for us is that we actually have a long track record of success in terms of peer evaluation, and also young people with accreditation being involved in taking decisions. And we need to kind of remember that that's actually what we want to be doing around, you know, participatory budgeting and actually ensuring that communities are getting involved in the decisions around funding, supported by, you know, intermediaries that have good trust and a long track record of actually delivering that activity.
I used to get into trouble quite a lot as a minister for being derogatory about the bean counters. Mr. Bruce, do you want to add anything?
No.
I want to go off at a little tangent here.
Can you do it briefly? Convener.
It'll be very brief. It'll be very brief. Obviously, you have highlighted some of the government's ambitions in terms of delivery. Let's take one of the government's ambitions in terms of meeting the promise. And Mr. Westwater talked earlier around about some longer-term agreements. Do you think there should maybe be the establishment of framework agreements with organisations for the delivery of policies such as the promise? And short answers would be great.
The short answer is yes, absolutely. And it's about that trusted relationship. And I think Sarah and others talked about what happened during COVID. And just to say, right, you know, there's a lump of money. We're worried about what's happening out in this particular field, whether it's children and young people or environment or poverty or whatever, and just get on with it and go and sort it. And the third sector, with a few minor, will get on with that. And so I think yes is the short answer.
And would this sector be supportive of the Scottish Government's battle with the UK Treasury to get longer term funding to be able to achieve that?
Well, I think, as you know, you said, I think if it's stuck somewhere else, then any blockage that we can support to remove, then of course, absolutely.
Correct. Anyone else want to come in on that? Because I'm taking it, it's all yes. Thank you very much, folks.
That's lovely, thank you. I'm now going to invite Minnie McNair, who's joining us remotely. Thanks.
Thanks, convener, and good morning, panel. Thanks for your time. I get the point about inflation and the real living wage and the cost challenges that both of them bring. Is there anything you would like to especially kind of highlight about this challenge? I'll pop it out to Ms. Overley first, if that's okay.
I mean, I think you've highlighted there what we all know, and I think what everybody in committee also knows, that the sector is facing unprecedented challenges around cost increases. So as an example, in the latest third sector tracker, which came out in April, so it's covering the 3 months prior to that, 47% of organisations reported cost increases within their top three challenges. And we've heard over the years repeatedly about organisations not getting any uplift at all. From one organisation, they didn't have an uplift for 13 years, which at that time was a decrease in their funding in real terms of 27%. It will be even more than that now because the amount that inflation has risen. So organisations are under real pressure and having uplifts within multi-year funding and funding more broadly, but of course we hope it's multi-year, is absolutely essential to the sustainability of organisations. Organisations have also, since COVID, dealt with increased demand, which I think the committee is aware of as well. So they've got increased demand and less resource with the rising costs and no uplifts. So it's an issue that really does need tackled. And it does really feel like one of those issues that, if not now, when we really are in sort of the worst position that we've been in terms of rising inflation, the need to pay staff more, the need to pay the real living wage, increased demand, then when?
Thanks for that. Anybody else want to come in?
So this one, I think, is probably for us, whilst I completely agree with Shelley that fair funding is a complete package, for us, inflationary uplifts are probably the thing that has been most damaging to the experiences of volunteers across Scotland. So we've seen a significant decrease in volunteer participation just in a couple of years. It's down 4%. More worryingly, we're also seeing an increase in the number of volunteers reporting that their volunteering is becoming too much like paid work, that the organisation's expectations are too high on them. These are really concerning for us, and I've mentioned already about the volunteer charter. That's why we are really pushing the volunteer charter, to try and encourage organisations to adhere to that. But if they don't get sustainable funding, then it's going to be increasingly challenging for organisations to provide sustainable volunteering opportunities for their organisations. And I think for us there is a concern that without sustainable funding that does create, as Mr Stewart had mentioned earlier on, it does create that challenge where there's potentially going to be a race to the bottom, where there's so much competition between organisations that people will be putting in unrealistic funding bids to try and secure their funding. And what that means is that other things will be getting, standards will slip. So, for example, one thing that we are really keen on, and it's part of the volunteer charter, is that all volunteers should get their travel expenses paid. That just seems like a given. And yet the Scottish Government are funding a major organisation, MCR Pathways, who don't provide travel expenses for their volunteers. So there's things like that, and that would maybe squeeze out other organisations who could potentially be providing that service whilst also providing a really, really positive experience for their volunteers.
Thank you.
I'm just wondering if I don't mind chipping in briefly, because I think you mentioned the real living wage in the same, and also the inflationary. And I think we're finding it's with organisations we support, it's almost a perfect storm, because there haven't been inflationary increases for a very, very long time. Been a standalone grant for certainly 10 more years. But now in the most recent grant offer letters, they're being told by as conditionality they must be real living wage, which all of us in this room would massively support. Nobody's against that. But in reality, those people are running, for example, the one I'm thinking of gets a core grant to run a service, but as part of that, really, they run a retail outlet and a cafe. They have people employed there, so they generate their own income. They match fund that grant with their own self-generated income. But putting the wages up to the real living wage, much as they would want to do it, pushes their cafe into deficit budget and insolvency. It's likely to close that cafe. So on one hand, they have to accept the core grant because they can't work without it, but the conditionality in real living wage without an inflationary increase means they're going out, they have to stop potentially generating income through that element because they can't make that business work. So none of this is perfect, but that's just the reality on the ground for some organisations. Thank you.
I think if I could just come in briefly.
That was my next question, obviously. I was going to kind of speak about that, obviously, any of funders expecting you to provide the real wage, but obviously not giving you the funding to do so. I mean, does anybody else have any other examples of that happening?
Yeah, I'd very much like to concur with that. And I think we've got rising demand, rising costs. I think that the UK grant-making survey said that there was a 33% cut in real terms last year from UK central government to charities. So that is also reflected in Scotland. And if we don't build in inflationary increases year on year, it leaves us with more and more disparity, especially with the public sector. So those that are trying to kind of keep up with the public sector, and in terms of that wage disparity, often the agreement comes quite a few months in to go back the way in terms of those wages. That puts real pressure, and it puts a kind of a real pressure to for employee security, for staff morale, to actually realise that we can actually keep pace in some ways with some of those increases. Because, you know, I have a graph, I'm sure many people have a graph in their office, which has showed the difference between sort of core grant giving versus cumulative inflation and other wage increases in the public sector over that period. And it goes like that. This is a longer term thing. It hasn't just appeared post-COVID. And it's something where the fair funding, the more multi-year funding, could help us plan ahead a little bit better around that. I do agree about the challenge of a race to the bottom. We sometimes see in some of the contracting that there's a pressure to not really consider overheads, not really consider management fees. I have to say that's not coming from some of our bigger charitable trusts or big funders. They get the need for core cost recovery. But I've sometimes found myself in conversations with, you know, public officials where there's really not an appreciation or understanding that we actually do need this money for our overheads and for management fees and operational costs. So I'm concerned about that. I'm also concerned about lack of contingency budgets as well. When we're given funds in the past, there used to be sort of a line for contingency and contingency planning. Doesn't seem to be there so much as well.
Thank you. Anyone else want to come in on that before I hand back to convener?
I'm going to invite Ian Bruce. Sorry, Maureen.
Just very quickly, I think the real living wage is the absolute baseline that we should expect, and many people in the third sector do very good, very difficult and challenging jobs, and actually their salary should reflect that. Our research into Fair Work a couple of years ago demonstrated a number of things, including the pay within the third sector was regarded as sitting well behind comparable jobs in other sectors, and I think we need to be addressing that, not perpetuating it. And I think the last bit around inflation is actually the impact that it has on staff in other ways. So certainly from our experience, where we see organisations not getting inflationary increases, they try and pay their staff a little bit extra, but what they actually have to compensate for that is to stop doing staff training, to stop investing in the extras in addition on top of that. And then, you know, you just start to create challenges.
Thank you.
Okay, thanks very much. I'm now going to invite Jeremy Balfour in. Thank you.
And good morning, everybody. Just two very brief questions. Sarah, maybe start with you on this one. Scottish Government have consulted around the fees for Disclosure Scotland, and with a suggestion that it should fall on the charity of the organisation to pay it rather than being picked up by the government. Can you just say what effect do you think that would have on volunteering, particularly for smaller charities?
It would be devastating, and it would be particularly for those organisations that support children and vulnerable groups. So given the Scottish Government's commitment to addressing child poverty, that's a particular challenge. I think that there's, for a lot of, if you're a paid employee, there's often an assumption that you will cover the costs of your PVG membership. But for volunteers, most organisations will cover that cost. So the likelihood is that cost will be transferred on to the third sector. We've estimated that the cost to the third sector would be around about £1 million, which maybe doesn't seem like a huge sum of money, but when you've got organisations that have had, you know, 20-25% real-time cuts in their funding, it's a particular challenge. And it's also a worry as well if it's not something that organisations have budgeted for. So for organisations who maybe only have a couple of their volunteers who are in PVG roles, and it maybe wouldn't necessarily have a huge impact. But as you say, Jeremy, if you've got a small organisation that's working with children or vulnerable adults, then that it could lead to the closure of that service or them having to look at alternative approaches. One other concern that we found in our when we were consulting with the sector on this is there was a concern that some organisations, particularly smaller ones, would try and fly under the radar and not seek PVG membership for volunteers that really should have them, which again would potentially be putting children and vulnerable groups at risk. So from a funding perspective, it's a bit of a perfect storm. So if they were to introduce this proposed removal of the fee waiver for volunteers and qualifying voluntary organisations, then it would have a potentially quite devastating effect for services, particularly for children and vulnerable adults.
I would just concur with that, and I was meeting with National Voluntary Youth Work Organisations, and it was a single thing that everybody identified as a concern. So given that many of them are working with thousands of volunteers across Scotland, and especially our uniform groups and others, they've already had the situation post-COVID of volunteer numbers dropping overall, and they're trying to build back with those volunteering, especially for younger adults as well, coming back in and volunteering to replace some people who've maybe retired and moved on from volunteering. So costs, especially for younger adults coming in to volunteering for the first time, extra costs could be a significant barrier for them.
Thank you. I wonder if I can maybe just start with Shirley for this question. We've heard from the Deputy Convener, we hear again from Scottish Government over and over, we don't know how much we're getting for Westminster Rush, we can't guarantee funding. Interestingly, they don't say that to doctors, nurses, to MSPs even, that you might not have a job in 2 years' time. What do you think that message gives to the third sector, that you're treated very differently from the public sector and to how many of them are treated? What message do you think that gives to the third sector?
Yeah, I think it gives the message that there's not parity between the third sector and the public sector. The third sector provides many public services and many very similar or even the same services as the public sector, but we aren't treated in the same way around multi-year funding, around uplifts. For example, we've seen in several emergency budget responses that there's been uplifts for staff across the private sector, but there's been no inflationary increases for third sector funding. So that gap is widening. So definitely within the sector, there's a sense that there isn't parity and there's frustration around that. And maybe a feeling that the sector's underappreciated and that the value of the work that the sector provides isn't appreciated in the same way as the public sector, which of course is really frustrating both for organisations, their staff and their volunteers, and for people in communities who benefit from voluntary sector services. So yeah, I think there is a lot of frustration, and especially over the last few years where there has been a lot of effort made to help the lowest paid in the public sector, but the same hasn't been for the voluntary sector.
I don't know if anyone else wants to come in on that.
Yeah, no, I would agree. I think for us it's the impact of being, for youth work I'm talking about now, not just for the third sector but also in local authorities, there's that challenge to keep parity because it's seen as less statutory. Even though there is a statutory guidance, it's not strong enough. So it does mean that once it comes after other key decisions about protecting funding around some of the big initiatives have happened, and that leaves it quite vulnerable.
I think, for me, I think investing in the third sector is very often investing in the capacity of communities at a local level, and it's an investment in prevention and early intervention, which is repeatedly the language that we use in policy and around public services in Scotland. So I suppose I think from that perspective, there is something really challenging, and I would be very reluctant to get into, you know, a direct comparison with nurses and the like, but there is a fundamental frustration, I think, around that recognition that if we genuinely mean we want to create services, we want to create a society where we are intervening early or where we are preventing bad things from happening rather than responding to them when they do, it would strike me that you would invest in communities as a fundamental rather than on an ad hoc basis.
Thank you, Camilla.
Okay, thank you. I wanted to touch upon more so the inefficiencies within the funding processes. So that's from the funding application form and also the reporting requirements as well, in terms of how burdensome they are. We heard from our workshop several people saying that there's good practice there with some applications. I don't know if I can't recall, it might have been Robertson's Trust. Was an excellent application form and whatnot. How do you think, or what could we do to try and streamline that? And I'm going to ask Sarah first of all on that one.
Thank you. I think there's a need for there to be standardisation across different application reporting mechanisms. There's also a need to make it a lot simpler as well. And I think as well a recognition that 72% of charities in Scotland don't have any paid staff. They're entirely volunteer-led. So you quite often you've got volunteers that are the ones that are undertaking these processes. So making sure that it's incredibly easy to understand, so plain English as a kind of matter of course, I think is incredibly important. From what we've heard as well, when you're reporting, having sort of consistency around outcomes and the indicators that are being used as well would be incredibly useful. And you're talking about the Robertson Trust. Another example that's particularly good from our perspective is Impact Funding Partners, who administer the Scottish Government's volunteering support fund. We work very closely with Impact Funding Partners, and we know the level of the support that they provide, particularly to those very small organisations that will have very limited staff. They won't have a designated person who deals with funding. It will be some part of somebody's job if they have a paid member of staff. And the model that they've adopted is incredibly good, and certainly they provide an awful lot of ongoing support to organisations. And I think that's a model that would be good to replicate to other sort of funding models.
Okay, that's really helpful. Does anyone else want to come in, Tim?
Yeah, just to say, I think we've been involved in lots of small grant-based funding for organisations and charities, and again, learning from what those organisations themselves, how they report and communicating with them, we spend a lot of time trying to simplify some of the, you know, jargon or some of the, you know, new policy initiatives and make them real for that level of funding. So for me, the word proportionate is really important here. Proportionate funding for grants of 5 and 10k, you would expect far more scrutiny for something of, you know, into 100,000, and more. But sometimes the nature of maybe quick turnaround funding can mean that there's all of the forms come with 35 pages of detail to fill in. That's not appropriate. I'm exaggerating to make a point, but sometimes it can feel like that in terms of that burden. One of the things that's fed back quite a lot as well is that there's not always a kind of a trust or an understanding of the level of detail of reporting as to how it'll be used. So, you know, if there's a kind of stop check or a visit to kind of see what's happening and to kind of see the impact of that, but sometimes it feels like there's a lot of detailed reporting without an overall summary of that. And in one or two cases, independent evaluations have been conducted and then they haven't been used in the next strain or you know, movement forward of funding. Okay. And that's a kind of concern as well.
OK. Douglas, would you like to come in?
Yeah, I mean, I think I suppose I mentioned this a few times. It's partly back to the trust issue, because a funder that doesn't trust an organisation gives them 35-page application forms. And I think it's partly about beginning to build that relationship that we're in partnership. And we are already. That already happens. That's absolutely not... It's not terrible. But I think building that where the government and Robertson Trust and Lottery, and there's a feeling that support agencies, funders and groups on the ground, as Ian has spoken about in communities, we're all in partnership to deliver a better Scotland. And we're equal partners. Some have got money, some have got contacts on the ground and lovely projects, some have got support to give, but there's something Sarah mentioned earlier, that feeling of that power disparity. So I think that's where that application form comes from. So we can build that trust, and they can be, well, let's sit together and work out what it is you're doing, what the impacts, how does it fit with the NPF, how does it fit with their policies, how does it fit with community wealth building, that's brilliant, right, how can we make that happen, and what safeguards will be put in place to make sure public money is spent and monitored properly. That has to happen too. So I think that relationship would improve and mean that the requirement for paperwork, and of course annual funding, as most of us have said, is you spend 6 months of the time filling in forms and reporting on them. So, you know, if it was 10-year funding, I wouldn't mind spending a month filling in a funding application, but you know, every year it's... And the only other quick thing I would say is that our experience from Social Enterprise Scotland, speaking to people across the sector, is we've talked a lot about third sector, maybe an assumption that it's third sector division, but we have organisations getting grants from housing, regeneration, from the economy, now that social enterprise have moved into the economy, and it's, I don't have a scientific answer to this, when people have told us there's different relationships and different demands across different departments, so the lack of consistency that Sarah spoke about, we see that across different divisions in government, and that would be good to tidy that up.
Okay, that's really helpful. Ian, would you like to come in?
For me, there's an equalities issue at the heart of this. What we have at the moment is a competitive process. designed as a competitive process, which fundamentally assumes that people are confident going through a mechanism and in the style that we do. And the result of that, when we look at funding for the third sector, is that there are communities in Scotland where there is less capacity in the community. And the result of our funding processes is that those communities actually receive less funding because they don't have robust third sector organisations that are able to apply for the funding. So I think there's something really fundamental in there. And then a wider equalities issue in terms of, you know, people's, you know, so we know, for example, that many of the organisations, you know, that you would expect to be led by people from disadvantaged backgrounds, are not led by the people from disadvantaged backgrounds. And that is led by the fact that, or some of that comes from the fact that actually to be successful, you need to be able to play this game of how you get an account for funding. The other point I simply wanted to make was just around, how we build the capacity of organisations and civil servants to really understand good evaluation. Because I think for a lot of organisations, they feel like they are putting a lot of work into monitoring and evaluation and feeding the beast, if you like, without any real sense of how that turns into learning, either for them or for government.
Just interesting when you talk about that. I don't know what any of your experiences are of getting onto a tender framework. So in my previous role, I sat on Scotland Excel, and we obviously looked at, you know, tender submissions coming through, and one of the tick boxes, and I think somebody alluded to earlier, was that you had to pay the living wage in order to get through. Have any of you got any experience of that, and also the reporting mechanisms as well for Scotland Excel when you're on that framework? Ian?
I suppose just, and it would be remiss of me not to say, is sometimes the thing that really stands out for us in terms of organisations feeding back to us is actually usually insurance requirements. That commissioners and Scotland Excel have exceptionally high insurance requirements on organisations, particularly around things like professional indemnity, that are significantly higher than most organisations of the sort of size that would be bidding for that contract would be likely to have. So it's just, I think that... very practical one.
Okay. Sorry, Douglas, did you want to come in there?
Yeah, I suppose obviously the kind of tendering and procurement side of things is quite a common thing that we spoke about as Social Enterprise Scotland, and it's something that we're keen to grow, significantly grow, and grow the proportion of third sector that are delivering services. And interestingly, some of the things that others have spoken about is there is a lot more freedom there to be able to add in things like core costs, because you're saying we will do it for that price, so take it or choose someone else, and you're able to put profit margins in and enough that you think you can put some money in reserves. So I think that's good. I mean, I could tell you a thousand things and about procurement. If I choose one thing that's back to the qualities thing that Ian mentioned that we'd like to see, and again, it's about process and government and how that might be a challenge, is just breaking things down. It's helping us as a sector to create cooperatives so we can have time to think things through and create partnerships and cooperatives so that larger bodies can tender for larger tenders but still get local and community benefit. That would be hugely supportive, and there isn't the capacity for it. People have talked about it, but there isn't the capacity for it. Or the other side, potentially breaking it down into smaller lots so that organisations with very particular thematic or geographical skill sets are able to tender for smaller things. So those things have been spoken about for a long time. Neither of those are new, but I think they've not been quite resolved yet.
Okay, that's great. Does anyone else want to come back in? Zira?
It's just a really small point. So if we're talking about making sure that funding processes are proportionate, it's important to remember, so we're talking about volunteer-led organisations, but actually volunteer-led organisations can be dealing with quite significant sums of money, particularly if you're looking at community asset transfer. Yeah. So you're looking fairly sizeable sort of capital projects where there's lots of money on the table. It's important to be proportionate, but also just to recognise that that level of sort of simplicity and accessibility is required across the piece.
So. Okay, that's great. Shelley, would you like to come in?
Just make one small point in that all of these sort of improvements we're talking about, process-based improvements, are areas that don't cost money, because often when we talk about improving funding for the sector, there's the idea that everything costs money, but all these sort of improvements to processes would really help the sector a lot when the sector is in a difficult position. They're essential to fair funding and they don't have a cost. So it would be really good if some of these things could be incorporated in and move along to create a more sustainable situation for the sector.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to now pass over to Paul O'Kane, and that will be the last line of questioning. Thanks.
Thank you very much. Convener, I suppose the challenge with being the last questioner is that we've covered quite a lot of ground, but I think what's important is just trying to pull some of this together that we've heard this morning. And certainly, I think, you know, in our conversation, we've been very focused on multi-year funding, and that is right, and that is obviously at the core of the discussion, but we know that fair funding principles go beyond that, and there are a number of different things that I think need to happen in order to move us forward. So I wonder if people might want to touch on anything that we haven't covered in terms of, I suppose, relationships, structures. We've heard about parity of esteem, for example. You know, what are those sorts of things that need to be not just put forward, but I think implemented and sustained to really help renew that relationship? And I'll maybe start with Shelley, if that's okay.
One issue that we maybe haven't really spoken about is transparency. So at the moment, we do have some commitments from Scottish Government around fairer funding. And of course, SFU are really keen for them to map that onto our fair funding work, which has been developed with the sector. But one issue is that some of the commitments the Scottish Government have made and commitments they make in future, we're not able to measure their progress. So first, we need Scottish Government to define exactly what fairer funding is, what their goals are, what their timelines are, but we also need transparency around Scottish funding at the moment and how much funding flows to the sector, how much of it is multi-year, how much of it includes inflation-based uplifts, covers the living wage, all of these things we don't have information on. So I think it's really important that when we think about creating a fair funding environment, we also create a place where we can hold Scottish Government to account on their commitments and actually see where there has been progress and see where there hasn't been progress. And I don't think that that's something that we have at the moment. And I think that's a real problem for actually seeing things progress and understanding what has improved and what hasn't. And I think that's also essential to sort of the trust that we spoke about earlier, because of course there's not going to be a lot of trust if no one understands what progress has been made and what hasn't been made and what the aspirations are. So that's just a point that I would raise.
Sarah?
Just to build on what Shelley said, there's some really interesting work going on in Wales at the moment, which might be worth looking at. So Wales already have a kind of compact with the third sector that's baked in. It was set up in 2014, I believe. But they're currently consulting at the moment on a code of practice for funding the third sector. So if we're looking at having principles like fair funding and there's potential there to formalise that a little bit more and maybe look to Wales for some inspiration on that.
Thank you. Yeah, but just a couple of minor points. I don't think there's an easy answer to this either. Sorry, I keep thinking of things that there's no easy answers to. But a wee bit of that's very solid thinking around innovation and new ideas versus investing in success. Organisations that have just been consistently providing excellent services over a very long period of time and embedded in the community, understand their beneficiaries and really making a huge difference. But they begin to feel a bit boring for funders. And I think a real think about, well, how much do we invest, or you as government and other funders, how much do we invest in innovation and new ideas and allow space for that, which I think is needed, but how much do we use our resources to invest in those trusted organisations? Because I think there are, I mean, I think we're certainly in community enterprise dealing with some very, very serious situations out there. We have an emergency service that we're helping people in. It's really, really challenging out there. And I think it's the final message, I suppose, is about, as a funder, what is the cost to the government when in your funding decisions? So we've seen not all government funding, I hasten to add, but organisations who have lost that funding and closed and been unable to carry on and gone insolvent. And for the sake of relatively small amounts of money, it's costing the state, the government, very large amounts of money because people are back at their CPNs, they're back at the doctor, they're going to daycare, they're going, you know, whereas they were getting quite a so there's a cost to not funding things as well.
And would you recognise some of the evidence that we heard when we met with organisations over the summer was about the challenge between innovation and trying to sustain something that works, and very often people get stuck in a cycle between, you know, it has to be new rather than actually something that has been proven to work. And I think you touched on that there, but is that something you would recognise?
I think absolutely, yeah, absolutely. And I think that's why I wanted to finish off with that point, that those trusted organisations, if they stop being funded, we don't just lose an organisation, we lose a lot in a community, we lose a lot of capacity, and it costs the nation a lot of money. And it's the preventative thing that Ian mentioned, it's that our approach is try to be preventative and to build capacity, and it can feel quite distant. It's not doctors and nurses and bobbies on the beat, but it's making very long-term savings to the nation. So it's that early investment and something that's going to save the very, very tight budgets that you guys are all dealing with, and local authorities and NHS and all of the public services are dealing with very tight budgets. But one of the ways to solve that is to fund early and small at this level, because very large savings could be made longer term.
Okay.
Yeah. Maybe I'll just pick up on the theme of prevention and universal services as well, and core services at community level. I think we've got a national conference coming up on prevention in November, with a focus on public health and education and policing. I think the third sector in particular is very good at looking across the portfolios and seeing the bigger outcomes we're trying to achieve around prevention and the social return and investment around that. So one of the challenges is that when we get into kind of siloed, target-based, bean counting focus, especially from some of our, you know, policy departments very much doing the thing that they want to do in their own world, the danger is that people are kind of jumping into those brackets rather than protecting some of the core delivery at a local level. So I think in terms of fair funding principles, we need senior level buy-in and an action plan. And I would suggest training as well, because we've got some brilliant models. We've mentioned some of the brilliant models of funding. Corporates as well, who have given sort of 2 or 3 year funding and had changed and adapted their expectations of what they're getting from communities and the way that reporting might happen. And we need to kind of avoid a situation where, you know, there's too much exceptionality. Okay, we've got this multi-funding, but it's not for this department and the team, and it's not for this government department. We've got to do this in a different way, because when you allow for too much of that exceptionality, there's always that sort of particular agendas being pushed, if you like, within the system that don't see the bigger picture and don't see those national performance framework outcomes. I just wanted to kind of say again about, I've seen fantastic examples of young people and peer evaluation happening. It's some of the most detailed scrutiny that any application, especially in terms of small granting, will get. Many of the young people are trained in participatory budgeting and grant-making processes, and I'm sure it's the same for other community groups as well. Real detail, real scrutiny, and it's very frustrating sometimes to see that process happen and then it get overruled at a more senior level. So I would encourage that to happen. I'd encourage training to happen for some of the key public servants involved in decision-making around funding processes, so that they're understanding the independent monitoring that happens. And also some of the evaluation and learning frameworks. We've not mentioned agencies like Evaluation Support Scotland and others who've done a lot of work to support and consider what good outcome-based measures are. So we need to use the material we've already got.
I wonder, Kavira, just finally, when Ian comments as well, maybe if you can say something about the connection with local government, which we've heard about as well, and that relationship. And we heard a lot about good and positive relationships between TSIs who are helping to manage funds, for example, whole family wellbeing and things like that. It doesn't work everywhere and there's not a consistency. So what would you want to see in that space?
You read my mind, because that's exactly where I was going. Because for me, there's obviously money that Scottish Government give directly to third sector organisations, but there are also significant pots of resource that Scottish Government allocate nominally to partnerships at a local level, local employability partnerships, children's services planning partnerships, for example. But in reality, those funds are held by the local authority, and I think there's a real tension there, because I think the aspiration of government is that money is used in a really collaborative way to redesign the system. But what it actually often ends up in is it's tied into the structures of the local authority, and we don't get that flexibility and innovation. And again, we come back to the power imbalances. You know, the person holding the strings, the purse strings, has control over the process. So I think there's a real challenge to the Scottish Government. If you're looking for that, if they're looking for that change that those agendas are trying to achieve, we need to think about how the governance of that resource is used, because actually that's where the critical things will make a difference.
Thank you, Convener.
Okay, thanks very much. So that actually concludes our question session. So thank you so much for sharing your views with the committee today. So we'll hold a further evidence session over the coming weeks, and so we'll hear from a whole host within the third sector organisations. So thank you once again. So that concludes our public business for today. We'll now move into private to consider the remaining items on the agenda. Thank you.